Welcome to all of our Forum Podcast listeners. My name is LJ Harry. I'm happy to be your host, and I'm very happy today to have with me our guest, Sister Stephanie Gossard, on the Forum Podcast. We're glad you're here. Welcome.
It's good to be here.
Good to have you here. Sister Gossard is the content manager for ABLE Ministries, which is a ministry of UPCI Ladies Ministries, and it stands for Accept, Believe, Love, and Embrace.
Very good.
It's an acronym, yes?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Excellent. And she has been teaching Sunday school since she was 15 and currently now serves as the disability coordinator for New Life St. Louis. And she's going to help us as teachers, as parents, to learn how to best support students who are dealing with disabilities. So once again, thank you for taking your time to help us.
Thank you. It's my pleasure to be here. I'm excited.
Me too. Well, let's start with our teacher's most frequently asked question, and that is, where do I start? I have a child in my class, or an adult, if this is an adult class, with a disability, and I don't know how to support them, or even I have a child at home with a disability. Where do I start? How do I support them?
Yep. So I think there's an overriding theory for both, and that is they want to be treated just like everybody else.
Okay.
So if you think about, if you have a five-year-old,
yes.
Right? What do typical five-year-olds do when they come to church? Do they all go downstairs to a Sunday school room?
Okay.
Right?
Right.
Do their parents probably don't go down with them and sit in the classroom with them?
Right.
Right.
That's a good point.
So you would want the five-year-old with a disability to experience church exactly or as close to the same as everybody else. With adults, it's the same.
Okay.
So, on Wednesday night,
yes.
What are the adults doing, right?
Okay.
If it's a female, do you have like a ladies group thing that happens?
Right.
Are they involved in that? So you just look at what typical people do,
okay,
and then try
yes.
to match that. With kids, we're kind of blessed.
Yes.
Because if they are in public school, there's a whole team of experts that sit down every year with the parents and they figure out what that kid needs for support in school.
Okay.
So if you think about how long are we in school for, like hours and hours and hours, right?
And hours and hours. And when you're young, and hours and hours and hours and hours and hours. Yes.
And I mean, at church we have them for like, you know, tiny little
yes.
bit compared.
Exactly.
So we can use that information from that document, which is called an IEP.
Okay.
To figure out what the supports are. Now, you don't need, you know, all 25 pages of that document.
Right.
So what we've done, what ABLE Ministry and PPH Curriculum has done, is created a form. It's 15 questions long.
Outstanding.
You just sit down with the Sunday school teacher and the parent, answer those 15 questions. At the end of that conversation, you know exactly what that kid needs.
Fantastic.
Yeah. So that's the easier. The adults... If you have an adult in your class, it's a little bit harder. You got to think through things.
Right.
But with the kids, it's pretty much just fill out this form and you'll have it.
Fantastic. So that's a...
Spiritual IEP.
Spiritual IEP.
Yes.
And that stands for Individualized...
Education Plan.
Plan. Okay. Mm-hmm. What are some of the questions, like the nature of the questions that are on that form?
So you would... They ask you... It asks to just describe your child, right?
Okay.
What is the disability in simple terms?
Okay, yes.
Because what you're going to do with this form eventually is to distribute it out to all the helpers and the Sunday school teachers in the room.
Okay,
right?
Yes.
So you want it to be pretty simple. You don't want it to be like a big medical document.
Right.
But just in simple terms, like what is your kid's disability? During parts of the classroom, how independent are they?
Oh,
right?
That's a great
so
question.
Like,
yes.
During snack,
right.
Do they need help? Do they need, you know, food cut? Do they need special food? Do they need during singing?
Very good, yes.
You know, are they overwhelmed by all of our energetic worship, right?
Right,
or do they love that and that's their favorite time?
Yes.
And so, and then it asks questions like, what motivates your kid?
Yes.
Right? So if you've got a kid who loves VeggieTales or loves
whatever,
right? We're dating ourselves a little bit here, but.
Yes, yes, we are.
Right? I'm sure there are more appropriate things to like at this day and age, but yeah. So what is your kid like? What's motivating? There was a kid who loved to cook.
Okay.
And like to watch like cooking shows on YouTube.
Right.
So maybe every Sunday school story that you tell involves some cooking.
Okay.
You know,
I mean,
they probably cooked during any Bible story. So
I would imagine, absolutely. We know Jesus did. After he resurrected, he cooked fish on the fire.
Right? Exactly. Yes. Yeah. So it just kind of gives you insight into what motivates, right, and what accommodations that kid needs.
Very good. Spiritual IEP. And how does somebody get a hold of one of those forms?
They can go to the Able Ministry UPCI Facebook group.
Okay, excellent.
And then in the file section, it's there. And also, if you order the God's Word for Life curriculum, did you
yes,
know this?
That's
yes.
The, what in was the, that again? Was it called
the,
what now?
The God's Word for Life for Kids curriculum.
That sounds like a wonderful curriculum.
Doesn't it? It's amazing curriculum. In the resources kit.
Yes.
It's in the download.
Okay, fantastic. So spiritual IEP.
You probably have it.
Which would be great, I would imagine, even for students who may not deal with a disability, but this will help you to know how to best teach and mm-hmm. minister to that child. Mm-hmm. I could imagine, especially in children's ministry, if you have a child who does need help at snack, or they may be too embarrassed to ask for help, but then they are embarrassed because they can't open up the snack, whatever,
right.
maybe
yeah.
their motor skills are not there.
Yeah.
They may be embarrassed when an adult offers to help because they want to be independent. So
right.
that would be a great way to stave off those embarrassing, awkward moments.
And it doesn't have to. We have spiritual IEPs at our church for, there's one kid who's just noise sensitive.
Okay, sure.
Like completely typical in every way, but can't stand loud noise. And so needs headphones
okay,
when
yes.
it's loud.
Yes.
So we have a whole spiritual IEP.
Yes.
It's there. That says when it gets loud, this kid needs headphones. So it doesn't have to be very complex medical, you know.
Right.
Yeah.
That's fantastic.
Mm-hmm.
What a great resource. And this that leads into our next question, and really we cover a little bit of it in that last one. How do we make students who are dealing with disabilities comfortable and part of the group without either focusing too much on what they're dealing with or ignoring it altogether as if it's not there?
Yeah.
What is the balance between making a student feel comfortable?
Yeah. So this question kind of makes me sad.
Okay.
Because if I am at a ladies' conference.
Yes.
And somebody comes up to me and says, my kid is being bullied at church. Unfortunately, that does happen.
Right.
99% of the time, they have not told anyone that that kid has a disability or a diagnosis.
Okay.
And I understand why they don't, right? So in our culture, there is shame around having a disability. We don't want our kids to be labeled. But I would say, without education, teenagers especially, can spot differences like that.
Sure.
Right? And they probably just apply their own labels.
Sure.
Which probably have nothing to do with disability and are probably very mean.
Sure.
So I think to ensure that kids are accepted as part of the group and involved, you really have to educate.
Okay.
And, I mean, whether that's, so educate their peers specifically.
Okay.
If a parent is not comfortable coming in and talking about whatever their kid's disability is, I mean, some parents are great about that. And they're like, I'll come in, we'll talk about, you know, autism, we'll talk about whatever. But if they're not comfortable doing that, at the very least, the Sunday school teacher can just spend some time talking about how God made everybody's brain different.
Yes.
Right?
Very good.
Like, not everybody thinks the same way.
Right.
Not everybody acts the same way. Some people need to move more than other people.
Sure.
Some people need fidgets. Some people don't.
Right, right, right. Right.
Right? Some people need to jump on the trampoline in the back of the room.
Yes.
Some people don't.
Yes.
A lot of people don't.
Right. But in a Pentecostal service, that would be very apropos.
Right?
That would
might be helpful.
Easier to hang on a chandelier,
right.
Which I've never seen done, but I've heard
swinging
from many
years.
Swinging
is very calming.
Exactly, that's right. It's very calming.
Yeah, so I mean, I think education is the answer.
Yes.
To having kids be included and be part of the group.
Very good. Now, obviously, the Bible tells tons of stories about Jesus healing people with disabilities.
Mm-hmm.
But then there are also some of those unknown, unsung stories where he does not heal. The scripture even says specifically that, for example, there were many lepers in Elijah's day, but only Naaman was healed. And then I think of the people who were at the Pool of Bethesda, and we know Jesus healed a man who was lame for 38 years, but what we probably don't really think about much is that was the only man that I believe John records Jesus healed. So it's likely he went through all, he went around others with disabilities, healed the one man, and then he and they left. Which leads me to ask, where is, again, the balance, or maybe even better termed, how do we pray? How do we pray for people, because we know God can heal, but how do we pray for people that if he does not heal them and he has a different plan? Like we know the man who was born blind in John 9, Jesus said, it wasn't because he sinned and it wasn't because his parents sinned, but one day the glory of God will be revealed. Mm-hmm. How do we pray in such a way that we do glorify God without crushing somebody's faith? And if we pray for them to be healed and they're not, how do we do that? That's a sticky one.
It is a sticky one. So I mean, the most obvious is, and I'm gonna rabbit trail just for a minute.
That's fine.
Is people who use wheelchairs.
Okay.
I can't tell you how many stories I've heard. People who use wheelchairs go up to the front.
Yes.
Get yanked out.
Oh, I've seen that.
Get told to walk.
I've seen
right?
that.
Right? And if they can't, they must not have had enough faith, or somebody must not have had enough faith.
Right.
Right. So I would say how not to pray.
Okay. Which it could
Which
be
is
very
easier,
helpful.
Easier answer.
Yes.
Is don't pray for healing unless that's what they're requesting.
Okay.
Right?
Very good.
Because, I mean, there are people who are in wheelchairs who want to walk.
Yes.
Who want people to pray for them. Absolutely.
Yes.
But if you walk up to a complete stranger who is using a wheelchair, don't assume, right, that
Very
they want to be
Very
healed.
Very good. Very
because
good.
They might have something more. I just realized this, like, recently. You know the guy where his friends couldn't walk, and his friends brought him to Jesus, and they had to, like, rip off the roof to get him.
Yes.
And they let him down in front of Jesus.
Yes.
You know what Jesus said the first thing he said?
What's that?
Your sins are forgiven.
That's true. Yes, you're right.
So Jesus was not
right.
as concerned that he couldn't walk. He was more concerned about his heart.
That's very true.
And so whenever people come up to our altars, don't assume that the reason they're coming up is for prayer for healing.
Very good.
And I would say, how do we pray for people? I mean, pray for families for strength.
Okay.
Pray for understanding and wisdom.
Sure.
Pray that teams of experts will come around them.
Yes.
And bless them. For people, a lot of people deal with, people with disabilities deal with anxiety. Mm-hmm. They deal with depression. They deal with not having friends and connection. They deal with lots of things that we can pray for, that we can assist with. But healing probably isn't the first thing we should pray for.
Very good.
Yeah.
I think in Mark 1, where Jesus meets the, or maybe, no, I'm sorry, it's later on. Maybe it's Bartimaeus. He asks him specifically, what do you want? And we look at that story and say, what do you mean, what do you want?
I mean,
the man's never...
Of course he wants to see.
Exactly, of course.
Yeah.
But he asked him specifically first, and then there's another passage, I don't remember the story, but he asked the person, wilt thou be made whole? So it's the same thing. He asks them just what you said, what can I pray for? How can I pray? What would you like me to pray about? Because you're right, it could be pray for my grandmother, pray for my whatever, but yeah.
Yeah.
Very good.
And I mean, we have popular examples of people who weren't healed, right? So Moses couldn't speak. God wants him to minister. Moses is like, but I can't speak.
Great point. Great point.
And what does God say? Who made your mouth?
Exactly.
That's right? That's not the answer I want, God.
No, not
right?
at all.
Like,
exactly.
I want you to make me perfect and according to my idea of perfection. And God just says, no.
Yeah.
No. I'll give you a helper.
Yes.
Right? He gave him Aaron.
Yes.
To be his helper, but he still required him to minister. And
Very good. Excellent. We're going to take a brief break. We are here with Stephanie Gossard, who's helping us learn how to best teach and minister to those dealing with disabilities. And we'll continue that conversation right after this. You're so
even in the trial, we'll put a trust in you.
And welcome back to the Forum Podcast. I'm LJ, and I'm here with Sister Stephanie Gossard, who is helping us learn how to best teach children, youth, and adults who are dealing with disabilities. And so far, this has been such a good conversation. So let's talk even more practically speaking. What accommodations can churches make? And let's start with the facilities to help people who are dealing with disabilities.
The one that immediately comes to my mind is people with who use wheelchairs need ramps.
Okay, yes, right? Absolutely.
Now, if you have a child in a wheelchair, you might say, why can't we just pick up the wheelchair and haul it up the steps, the front steps?
Right.
That kind of works with a child, but you wouldn't want to do that with an adult.
No.
Right?
No, unless you've got some serious...
Yeah. So there are ramps that you can purchase.
Okay.
To set up, or you know, if you've got men that are handy in your church, you can do a ramp.
Sure.
There was a pastor in Minnesota who made a ramp for $100, and he just grabbed some plywood and flipped it around and made it for $100. So
fantastic.
But there are the issue with ramps is that if a person with a wheelchair is actually going to go up the ramp, you need so many. You can't have it be very steep, right?
Right.
So you have to have a certain angle.
Yes.
And it's so many feet per so many inches of elevation, blah, blah, blah.
Okay,
and
yes.
So they can get quite long if you're very high. There are also, they're like square, I forget what they're called, but they're square things that people with disabilities just, they roll their wheelchair on it and then it just lifts up.
Oh, yes.
And it's just like for
yes.
one. It's not a
exactly.
complete elevator, it's just for one.
I've seen those, absolutely.
So that's a less expensive way rather
yes.
than putting in a whole elevator.
We had in our church in Mount Vernon, Ohio, before we moved to the new building, we had one of those chair lift deals.
Oh, yeah.
That it was just a single-use chair. It was so slow. We would lift up somebody out of the wheelchair,
yeah,
put them in that
yeah.
chair, and it was...
Up the stairs.
Yes. By the time you get up the stairs, we're already three verses into the first song.
It's just...
Yes.
I'm sure it's very safe, though.
Yes, yes. Right? It was not too fast
they
for them.
They were not going to fall out on the way out.
No. And we had two shuttles in Mount Vernon with wheelchair lifts on, a wheelchair lift on each one.
Nice.
And so that was a huge help because we had a senior apartment complex of ladies who would come to Bible study and Sunday school and Sunday worship. And so we would bring them in wheelchairs on those shuttles.
Nice.
And it was a great opportunity to minister to people who wanted to come to church, but nobody else could or would make that accommodation. And it is a sacrifice to go through those extra steps, and certainly it's an expense to buy a shuttle that has a wheelchair lift, but it was a wonderful blessing to be able to have that.
And then from a Sunday school standpoint, if you have a kid who uses a wheelchair,
right.
you want to make sure that, you know, you're... spaces between the tables or the chairs are wide
yes,
enough, right?
Yes.
And have a space for them so that they don't have to like yank a chair out every time they
right.
go to sit down. Make sure that they can roll under it so that it's at the appropriate height. I mean, a really basic thing is that if you have a person with a wheelchair sitting behind you, you probably don't want to stand up right in front of them. Right?
I've never thought about that, but that's an excellent
Because they're
point.
Just looking straight at your backside, basically.
Right, right.
Which is not
there
ideal.
Are better, yeah, yeah.
Right? And if you're in a Sunday school class.
Yes.
And all the kids, you know, let's all come over here. And they're all standing right in front of the person with the wheelchair.
Right.
As a teacher, you can say, oh, you know, he can't see. Everybody just scoot.
Exactly.
So he can see. So that you're teaching them from a very young age.
Yes.
Right? And then as they grow up and get older and become adults,
yes.
then they have that awareness already in there.
Very good.
What else? Physical.
Yes.
Do you want to talk about sensory rooms?
I was just, you have read my mind. I was going to ask about sensory rooms.
Sensory rooms. So often when people hear that we have a disability ministry, they immediately think you need a sensory room.
Okay.
Or you need like a whole wing.
Right.
need all this stuff. You don't always need a sensory room.
Okay.
But if you have people with disabilities who get overwhelmed by all that we are, right?
Yes, exactly. Exactly.
Then you might want to provide a space for them to go that's quiet.
Okay.
Where they can reset.
Yes.
Often in a sensory room, you might have a trampoline.
Okay.
To like jump and get energy out. You might have things that are tactile, so mermaid material where you can like touch it and draw things into it, or kinetic sand, or fidgets, or stuff that they can touch and feel and manipulate.
Yes.
So that can be helpful. It isn't a place, the sensory room is not a place where people just go and stay the entire service and you never see them again.
Okay.
It's usually a place where you go and reset
and
then come back. And join. So a sensory room could be used in Sunday school. You know, if there's a particularly very exciting activity and they get overwhelmed, they can go reset, come back.
Yes.
Or in service, you know, maybe our worship service is too loud for them and noise canceling headphones or earplugs don't work. They could go there during worship or they could go there during and then come back for the other parts of the service.
So the room doesn't have to be completely outfitted to just be solely a sensory room. It could be, like in Mount Vernon, we had a library that was right off the sanctuary.
Mm-hmm.
So they could go in there and have some of those tactile. What are the things called that have the little, they're not dots, but they're little...
Little poppets?
Yes,
fidgets?
I like those. I think those are great. So yeah, anything like that mm-hmm. would help them.
Yeah.
Excellent. Very good. What are your top do's and don'ts? And probably more don'ts than do's when dealing with people.
We do like
ministering to people who are dealing with disabilities.
Sure. I would say don't segregate.
Okay.
So if you had two people show up at your church who used wheelchairs, you would never say, well, you know what? We like to jump. And we like to stand up during worship.
Right.
You can't do that. So we're going to give you a separate room with your own special worship service.
I see.
Right? We would never do that. That would be ridiculous.
Right, right.
We don't want to do that with kids either.
Okay.
So if you have a kid with a disability in Sunday school, do everything you can to keep them in with the typical kids.
Okay.
So that might mean when they first start, when things are really new and everything's, you know, they might need a person right beside them the entire time.
Yes.
Or, as they get used to the routine and the schedule, maybe that person could back off and they could just be in the room. So somebody to step in. Or everybody in the room knows what that kid needs and can just step in as needed. Or a peers could step in as needed.
Yes.
So don't segregate. Try to keep them with everybody as often as much as possible. Now, there are times, like I mentioned, like some kids get overwhelmed with activity and loud noises.
Mm-hmm.
There might be times when they needed to go to the sensory room.
Right.
Right? But don't have that be the only place they go. Bring them back in with the typical kids whenever they can.
Yes.
When they can. Because most kids could probably eat snack with typical kids.
Right.
Right?
Exactly.
Action songs.
Yeah.
You know?
Exactly, yeah.
There are probably parts of your Sunday school where they could participate with typical kids. So.
Yes.
So that's one don't. Don't segregate.
Don't segregate. That's good.
One we already talked about. Don't pray for healing.
Right. Exactly.
Unless asked, right?
Exactly.
And then assume competence. Like
that's,
on the do side.
That's a good do, yes.
Right? Assume that that kid wants to do their very best.
Right.
Like assume that they didn't wake up this morning and decide that they were going to ruin your class.
That's excellent.
Right? Even though it might seem like that's what they decided.
Right?
Right? When you get there and that kid is just winging off the walls and you're like, assume that that's not their intent.
That
assume
is fantastic.
That they need, that whatever they're doing, whatever behavior it is that they're doing, assume that they, that there's a need, that they're trying to communicate something.
Yes.
So that kid that can't sit still, there's a need there.
Yes.
That kid that is touching everything and everyone and poking people, and it, there's an underlying need there that's not being met.
Sure.
Figure out what that is, and then you won't have to deal with that. So assume competence. The other area to assume competence is kids who have less cognitive ability. So maybe they're delayed.
Right.
Right? Even, I mean, this is true with adults.
Exactly.
True with teenagers. Like, they might be 4 years behind. They might be 6 years behind. But God is still filling them with the Holy Ghost.
Yes, He is. Yes, He is.
And sometimes we're amazed.
Yes.
I don't know why we're amazed, but sometimes we're amazed. Like, if you go to the Able Ministry UBCI Facebook group,
yes,
you'll see parents posting like, I never thought this would happen.
Wow.
Da, 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 and they got the Holy Ghost that week. Because God desires a relationship with people.
Yes, He does.
Regardless of their IQ.
Yes.
Regardless of their behaviors.
Yes.
I mean, there's one kid that I went to a church. He would not sit still. He literally was running around children's church, like in circles, down the hall, in the classrooms, touching everything, touching. And they would just send him upstairs.
I see.
Right? Because what are you going to do with
what
that?
What do you do?
And so I just happened to be there for something else and observed him. And I was like, oh, try this, try that, try the other thing. They did.
Mm-hmm.
And about 6 weeks later, someone emailed me and said, guess what? That kid just got the Holy Ghost.
That's so beautiful.
And in my fleshly self, you
right.
know, looking at this kid that just was not obviously not listening,
right.
probably was, but didn't seem like he was listening.
Yes.
Just like being crazy disruptive, God filled him with the Holy Ghost.
That's beautiful. There is something within us, even if cognitively we don't get it, but
yeah.
spiritually. There is a connection that we want to connect with God.
Mm-hmm.
And that's beautiful to see that He's doing that. By all means, check out the Facebook page, Able Ministry Facebook page, and read some of those testimonies. And
mm-hmm.
that's fantastic. What are some other great resources as we wrap up? Some other great resources teachers can use to help them minister to students dealing with disabilities.
Yep. So we mentioned the spiritual IEP.
Yes.
In the resources kit.
Great resource of God's Word for Life.
God's Word for Life curriculum. There's also resource pages
okay.
in that same area.
Okay.
So what the resource pages are, it's 8 common disabilities.
Okay.
So if you're a Sunday school teacher, children's church worker, and a kid walks in with Down syndrome, and you don't know anything about Down syndrome.
Right.
You just grab that resource page.
Right.
And it has an overview of what Down syndrome is, and there's a little section over on the right that tells you how, where to start.
That's fantastic.
Right? So here's some things to know about Down syndrome, and they might need this, that, like the top 10 things.
Yes.
Right there on the resource pages. So that's available.
Outstanding.
Yeah. So helpful. Because, I mean, frankly,
yes.
like, you're not going to memorize. I mean, how many
no.
disabilities are out there? You're not going to memorize all of them.
No, no.
And often just knowing where to start,
right?
You know, is helpful. So
that's a great resource.
That is out there. We have mom's groups.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of getting away from the Sunday school thing.
That's okay, though.
Children's ministry. But disability affects the whole family.
Yes, it does.
And
yes,
we have, in the spring and in the fall, we have virtual mom's groups. Where moms can get together, because sometimes it can be rather lonely.
Sure.
You've got a kid. It's the only kid in the church.
Right.
You feel like I'm the only one in the world that has a kid with a disability.
Right.
Right. So as a Sunday school teacher, point them our way.
Very good.
And they can get out there and access those resources.
And that's through Able Ministry as well, is that
mm-hmm.
right?
Yes.
Okay, outstanding. And then also, again, not to make a just shameless plug for God's Word for Life, but within the God's Word for Life youth and children's curriculum, there
yes.
is a special education supplement that helps to change the language of the lesson to make it more understandable. For example, I was editing one of the lessons and it was said something like, Jesus walked into the cold embrace of death. And of course, that's referring to Him going to the cross.
Mm-hmm.
But that's metaphorical. And so to say the SPED supplement, special education supplement, changed that to Jesus willingly died on the cross for us. It changes the language from metaphorical and theoretical that somebody who may struggle with some of those concepts, those abstract concepts, would not understand. And so we would leave them behind. Well, the SPED supplement makes sure that we don't leave them behind, but we minister to them and help them grow in their walk with Jesus.
Yeah. And that's in the resources kit download as well. Same place.
Also in the resource kit download.
Right,
it's all
resource.
Right there. What a great resource is that resource kit.
Get that God's Word for Life
of
curriculum.
God's Word for Life. That's right.
Yeah, so on the younger kid side, yes. They don't use quite as many metaphors and that
right.
type of thing.
Right.
So on the younger levels, it talks about, you know, this game won't work for somebody who uses a wheelchair.
Oh, absolutely.
What can you do? You
yes.
know what I mean?
Yes, exactly.
So it gives information like that as well. And it has general accommodation, so fine motor, right? So
oh,
if you got
sure.
kids that can't color very well, or what
right.
can you do for all those kids?
Right.
It's a whole section. And then it takes every lesson and walks through every activity.
Yes.
And says, you know, this might not work for this type of kid, this might not work for that type of kid, and gives you suggestions. So
that's fantastic. That is a fantastic resource. So we've got a lot of great resources to be able to help our teachers teach better, yeah. those who are dealing with disabilities.
And I mean, our Facebook group is very caring.
Awesome.
So
that's
I was doing a Sunday school lesson, and it was before we had all these resources, the disability supplement, and it was the story of the blind man.
Okay, yes.
And it said, blindfold all the kids and have them walk around the room and stumble into things.
Oh.
And I was like,
right.
That. I'm not sure if that's the right thing to do.
Right, right.
And so I went out to the ABLE Ministry UPCI Facebook group, and I posted it, and I was like, I'm a Sunday school teacher. Is this really what we want to do? And within 2 hours, 60 people had commented. Two of them were blind, and they were like, yes, it is, and you should do this, this, this.
Wow. How fantastic.
Right? So,
fantastic.
I mean, if you don't know,
yes,
you know, and it's not in the supplement, and it's not here, and it's not there,
yes.
just jump out there and ask, and people are very kind and are happy to help. So
excellent.
Yeah.
Well, thank you. Thank you so much. You've really blessed us. Would you be willing to pray
sure.
over our teachers and our parents
sure.
that the Lord would help
sure.
us?
Jesus, we love you.
Yes, we do.
Thank you so much for the community that we have. Thank you so much for those who reach out and accept and believe in and minister with people with disabilities.
Thank you, Lord.
God, I ask that you touch our Sunday school teachers and our children's workers. Give them wisdom.
Yes,
Lord. Give them understanding. Touch our kids as they integrate in with our typical Sunday school and all of the fun and exciting things that we have. God, touch our parents and touch those that are providing curriculum and accommodations.
Yes, thank you, Lord.
Give them wisdom in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Well, thank you again. You've really blessed us. And I know those listening and watching this episode are going to be helped. So thank you.
It is my pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you. And thank you for joining us for the Formed Podcast. If you have not yet visited the ABLE Ministry Facebook page, be sure to do that. It'll really be a great resource for you. And then also visit PentecostalPublishing.com for some other great resources, such as God's Word for Life. With all the resource kits available and all the SPED supplements and other resources to help you disciple those you are teaching. Next month, join us. We're going to hear from another teacher or trainer who will help us once again train teachers in the local church.